So recently, I was thinking about how I can ensure a steadier stream of videos. What does every brilliant education channel have in common? They freaking implemented their own motion graphics system. I want that. So let's build Flash. But before we build Flash, let's go back to 2005 and experience Flash again. I would spend hours on Newgrounds, watching quality content, and playing amazing games. Some of these games even became iconic series. This was all thanks to Flash. Flash had two parts, the Flash player and the editor. The player is now dead. It died in 2020, but the editor actually still lives on in Adobe Animate. Honestly, the right move is that I should just use their editor, but I want to learn, which means we're reinventing the wheel and going on an adventure. Now, I'm not going to build the whole of Flash. Instead, I'm going to build a proof of concept that can create an animation. I want the preview to be completely powered by browser technologies, and my keyframes should allow me to write any JavaScript that I want to execute on a frame. This logo fracturing animation was created using the tool I'm building in this video. Ah, nothing like starting a fresh new project. Here are all the dependencies I'm going to use. MobX is going to be the state store. Lit is the library I'll use to create the visual interface. It's small and fast. Full disclosure, in my day job, I work on Lit. I also don't want to rebuild every component. There are things like buttons and dropdowns that I'd like someone else to build for me. For that, I'm using Shoelace. Their site, shoelace.style, is a great showcase of stuff I'm going to be able to reuse to make this editor quickly. For example, they have this split panel element, which will make it really easy to make the whole editor resizable. The first thing we need is a couple elements that we can implement as we go. We'll need an appshell component. This will contain the whole thing, the options side panel or inspector, a preview canvas, and the timelines container. Because you may not be familiar with Lit, here's a quick rundown. HTML contains lots of helpful elements, like inputs, labels, form, and of course, marquee. But sometimes, it's missing an element that you wish it had. Luckily, browsers let you invent new elements, called custom elements. Lit element uses this browser feature to give you a little HTML element class with reactivity and templating built in. Then you can use custom elements.define to tell the browser, hey, associate this HTML tag, like button, to this JavaScript class that makes the like button. So the answer to many questions about Lit are answered by asking, what does the browser do? For example, how do you make a new Lit element? So knowing this, let's go through the appshell component code. It is a class that extends Lit element. Static styles is where CSS goes. It is automatically scoped to your component. So here we're saying, I want myself, the appshell, to have a nice thick gold border whenever I'm put on the page. Then in render, this is what the appshell looks like. In this case, its name. And maybe the most important part is the custom elements.define line. But nothing works yet because our site doesn't have an HTML entry file. So let's make that. And add our appshell HTML element. Look at that nice gold border. Now you know where HTML and CSS go in Lit. We can now scaffold the editor. SL split panel is a shoelace split panel. And this first one is the vertical one. And it takes two children, its top and bottom. And in the top, there's another SL split panel. And this contains the preview and the options panel. Then in the preview canvas element, there's the same sort of stuff. It contains an animation container div called main surface. Main surface has a aspect ratio of 1920 by 1080. So once we render this animation, it should be the resolution of this YouTube video. And just for testing purposes, I've put some text on the screen. And guess what? The browser thinks this container is a website. Here are some advanced visual effects to replicate what I want to happen. How can we do this using just styles? I don't think there is a way. Instead, I used a resize observer. Whenever I make the element larger or smaller, it triggers the resize observer to call the resize main surface method. And the logic of resize main surface, that is where we scale the main surface so it behaves like a video. Let's go through it. We get the width and height of both the main surface and the custom element itself. Then we figure out the desired aspect ratio. Now we can take the container's dimensions and ask, what would the main surface look like if it was scaled by width or by height? And then we use an if statement to pick the option that isn't overflowing the parent. This gives us a desired width, but we still need to figure out how to scale the element. We can figure that out by dividing against the original unscaled width, and that's our scale. While we're here, we can also center the canvas by calculating margins. Then we apply our center translation and scale. With this change, that's the hardest part of the preview canvas done. Next, I want to be able to change what appears on the canvas. So let's add the most powerful feature, a code editor in the browser. I'm going to share the preview container in the simplest way by adding it to a window. It should also start empty, ready to be filled by our keyframe code. For the options area, I'm going to keep things simple. It's a text area with some styles. The magic is all done on input. When I type in the text area, this input event passes what I've typed into the construct function from text area method. Then in that method, I literally make a new function from the text contents. We can immediately execute the function, passing in the surface and lit module. And just like that, you can now type in the text area to change what is on the surface. Incredibly, the hardest, unique parts of the project are now done. Because to make a working animation, all we need to do now is create a list that contains our keyframes. And for each entry in the list, we store the function from the text area. And to play the animation, we'll keep track of the current keyframe and execute that function. Multiple layers are just multiple lists, each with their own container in the preview. All of this is a state complexity problem, and is where having something like MobX starts becoming quite useful. The overall flow of data with MobX looks like this. The user does something in the interface, like selecting the third frame. This calls an action called setSelectedFrame on the MobX store, which sets the selected frame to 3. And magically, the application reacts. Lit element needs to be extended slightly to know how to react to MobX, but luckily the work has already been done for us. Lit has a preact signals mixin that is extremely close to what we want. So we can yoink that and place our copy in a vendor directory. Also yoink the license file, yoink responsibly. The only change I want to make is to swap out the preact effect function with a MobX auto run function, and the name MobX auto run watcher is also better. And that's all. Now we can just apply this mixin to each of our components that need to react and store changes. And then I just coded a bunch, adding actions and using state in the application to finally end up with this. Here is a screen recording of me making the logo fracture animation. I render the lit logo over itself a couple times, then cut out each fragment using the CSS property called clip path. We can use some math to move each fragment between its 0 to 1 position, scaled by some amount. And that's how we got to the final result. But just coding can get a bit tedious. Since we can already run any arbitrary code on a keyframe, we can actually cheat a bit and just hard code a special keyframe type. This is a sketch keyframe type, and it has a function that draws an HTML canvas and sets up some events so that I can draw on it with my mouse. Then when I stop drawing a stroke, the pixels which make up the canvas get saved as a huge list of pixels in the browser's IndexedDB database. And now, it's time to take this tool for its maiden voyage. Now that I have this tool, I'm sure I will make more videos. Subscribe.